descriptive, unnegative distinctions, though if you have some diagnostics, we will talk about those when we do causatives. Okay, so, but that's actually a lot of work, so I don't want you to do the negative, unnegative distinction unless you really cannot stop yourself, in which case you can do that. But I will actually ask you to do something else, which is look for ordinations. Okay, so you don't need to know anything about conjugatives and unaccusatives to know that in Hindi, cut and car and khul and khol are somehow related. Okay, so one kind of network. So what we are trying to do is we have this long list. We are trying to annotate this list and develop connections between the verbs in this list. And the goal is that in the end we have a resource that anytime you have a thought about some, you make some kind of prediction about a verb, you immediately can then go to this list and say, what are the other verbs which have this property? Can I check them against all of those verbs? Okay. So this is, in the end, the idea is that as a result of all the work that we've done here in, that we do here in these 10 days, we will have created a resource at least for 3 or 4 languages that we can make publicly accessible and that other people can eventually contribute to it. Because no matter what we do, right, what we do in these 5 days, it's not going to be a complete resource. There are lots of verbs and you do not think of all of them. So we are not really aiming for exhaustivity here. But still, if you think of a verb, put it in. Okay. I'll spell this out, but right now I'm giving you some of the contours of the problem. So we want to identify any alternations. So first, what you will do is you can, for example, let me give you one alternation in Hindi. Okay. And that is such a sort of reliable alternation or reliable process that in that list, I have not even listed those verbs. So these are the ba verbs, right? But Ram ne ghar banaya, Ram ne ghar banwaya, right? So bana to banwa, right? That is, it's a very, very common process. And so for Hindi then, you might want to then indicate which verbs do not do that, because there are verbs that do not do that. So there is a very interesting class of verbs, and I love these verbs because they sound so nice. Like these are verbs like, these are sound, often they are sound verbs, they are onomatopoeic words which end in a, like mimia rahi hai, or bilbila. They're all like khatkata. Yes, I love them. I mean, you make a list and then if you're feeling down, then you can read the list and then you start smiling. Okay, but the interesting thing is that at least I don't think there is such a thing as khatkatwa. Ram ne Ramesh se darwaza khatkatwaya. At least, I mean, maybe we can produce them. I don't know. I find it hard. So for these verbs, then what we could do is instead of indicating that they can participate in the va alternation, that they can, but what we could do is we could indicate that they cannot participate, right? So if there is a completely productive process, then we could say, or let's take another example. Let's take the verb a, come, or ja. I don't know how to make java, awa. I don't know that these verbs have causative, var causatives either. Okay, so now what we have is, we had the ergative, not ergative. What alternations do you participate in? Do you participate in the var causative alternation? There will be other things like, what kinds of, so for, there will be some verbs that take something other than DP complement. Okay, so then you would want to classify them according to what kind of complement do they take. Okay, so in Hindi, the choices are not that many. So you can either take an infinitival complement of some sort, you can take a finite clause complement, or maybe we'll talk a little bit about this, you can take something that's called a subjunctive. Okay, so you can take a subjunctive complement. That's about it. So you could have some classification according to that sort. And then finally, majority of verbs, and one thing I will, to simplify the task and to limit the task right now, and maybe for Marathi speak, I mean for Marathi this will make the task very, very easy. So let's not do the NV predicates right now, or AV, let's do verb, okay? So for example, we will, if you were doing Hindi, this means you would not do mehnat karna. You would do karna, but not mehnat karna, because these NV predicates are interesting. I will actually talk about them, and then people can, so this is actually project number one that is being suggested. Something else will be suggested after this. But so what you want to do is you want to go through the list of predicates, and then once you have created a list, let's say, once you have created a list of intransitive predicates, the predicates that take only one argument, most likely there will not be much more to do there, because they will be, those intransitive predicates will be taking nominatives. Okay. But if they don't take nominative, then you have something to say, right? So for example, if you, we discuss the fact that in Hindi, there are no such predicates. That in Hindi, there are no, if in Hindi, it's very easy. If you're an intransitive, you take a nominative. End of story. Okay. You, it is not possible for an intransitive predicate to have just one argument which is dative or something else. There, this, so you might say, what about Ram ne khasa? That's not real, because that will become Ram khas raha hai, right? And so then you get a nominative. So that is not inherent, that's not fixed in the in that regular sense. Okay. So that's the. But when you come to transitives, things will become interesting, because then you might find predicates like the Hindi mil, Ram Sita se mila. Right, which is unpredictable. So what, here you should try and identify two things. What is the default pattern? Okay, so for Hindi, the default pattern is single, so not just default, for intransitives, it's exceptionless as far as I know. If you find any exception, I mean, I'm saying it's exceptionless, you should not be, in general, whenever your teachers tell you something about facts in a language, you should immediately doubt them and try to break the fact. And then, if you can't break it, then you should leave them. But if you should try it. So I'm saying that it's exceptionless, but who knows? I mean, so the default for Hindi, exceptionless thing for intransitives that emerges is NPV. Okay, so there's just no marking on that's there. For transitives, for monotransitives, the thing that emerges is subject, which may or may not get ergative, and object, which may or may not get differential object marking. But so in principle, both the subject and the object can be there. Okay. Now what happens is that with some predicates, it may be that their object is so, by the semantics of the verb, the object is, let's take the verb bulana, to call. Right. Generally, when you call people, you do not call non-specific things. You do not call chairs. You call people. So with bulana, I can't think of a way to give bulana an object which is not co-marked. Ram ne Sita ko bulaya, Ram ne mujhe bulaya, Ram ne usse bulaya, but Ram ne wo bulaya. Right. That does not work. But can you say things like Ram ne mujhe gatha bulaya? Right? So that further suggests that maybe what's happening is that bula might actually be underlyingly a ditransitive predicate. He called me X with the X that goes missing. So anyway, so the point is you want to identify for each class. So let's say for your monotransitives, you identify a general pattern. So this will make classification easier. So you say the general pattern is that the verb takes a DP object which participates in differential object marking. Okay. So what, once you do that, what you start going through your list of verbs, let's say you have 50, quite likely 40 of them will fall in that camp. And then you don't need to worry about that. But then some of them will not fall in that camp, and then you subclassify them. And then a third, then after this, you'll be left with the ditransitives. So predicates like give, okay, or send, and then you classify those. Yes.
So like these kind of verbs would be transitive or
diagrammative.
Is there
a transitive?
Yeah,
no, so transitive and then there's a subclassification. Oh. Right. So then so that's why so in a way they are transitive because they have an external argument and so on, and they have internal arguments, but then there's right. Thankfully, languages are, this exercise could have gone on forever, but thankfully, we don't know why, but actual languages do not go beyond that. So there are ditransitives, but it's very, very rarely that you hear about tritransitives. Especially if you limit yourself to DP arguments, then I don't know of any tritransitives. Maybe, with Kashmiri causatives, you might be able to construct something that borderline looks like a tritransitive, but not really. But yeah. So, well, I have a colleague, Lynn Fraser, who's like a really important psycholinguist. She gave me this example of a tritransitive, but it's not with DP. So, I bet you $100 that Trump will lose. So I bet you to $100 3 that Trump will lose 4, right? But the thing is, this works because that last guy is a sequence. You could not make it work if there was a clause there.
Yeah. So,
maine Meena ko pencil se khat likha, right? So the say there is, so this would be an interesting exercise thinking about what are adjuncts, what are not. So the idea is instruments are not going to count. And so for this exercise, unless you find instruments which are obligatory, which you cannot leave out, leave them out. Because if you start including instruments, the generalizations will not come out straightforward. There was one other, okay, so then I said what to do with the, right, so again, when you're doing these verbs, see if you can get, if dative subjects come into the purview. It's possible that a lot of dative subjects will not come into the purview, because at least in Hindi, a lot of the dative subject constructions, I mean, I said this, right, that in Hindi there are no dative subject constructions where you have just one DP. You always have, it's always DP dative, DP nominative verb. So, but even so, I mean, in Hindi, a lot of those things, they are, a lot of these dative subject constructions are could be classified as complex predicates. But, so we are interested right now in cases like, there's this interesting, somewhat limited alternation in Hindi between dikhna and dekhna. Okay, this alternation is a very special alternation. It's not like khulna and kholna. Okay, with khulna and kholna, you have a difference in the number of arguments you have. Right, so the door opened, John opened the door, 1, 2. But with dikhna and dekhna, you have the same number of arguments. So with dikhna has a dative subject, Ram ko chidiya dikhi. So that means he wasn't looking, he was just looking like this, and the bird comes, I'm just describing this. So the bird comes into his field of view, and so the bird appears to him in a way. But it's not that the bird is doing anything, it's just right. While Ram ne chidiya dekhi is more agent. But it's the same in both cases, Ram is seeing and the bird is being seen. But it's these are two very different we were talking about samajna, right? This which had with variable or gativity. So, with a slight tweak, you can get this there also. Ram ko baat samaj aayi, to Ram, this thing in his understanding came, versus Ram ne baat samji, right? So, Ram ne baat samaji, where he did something. Ram thought of me, Ram ne mujhe yaad kiya, Ram ko meri yaad aayi. Yeah. Anyway, this is a digression. So the point is, if you have verbs which take dative subjects like technically this would be a category of transitives, but it's a funny category of transitives because at another level, once we analyze them, these will actually be more like the intransitives because these predicates are all unaccusative. They are not really transitive predicates. So we can, because once we, this is, right now we are doing the cut on the basis of the number of arguments because it's an easy cut. It doesn't, in the end, the cut that we would probably want to make is, do you have an external argument or not, right? And that would give you a very different cut because then Nahana and Hasna, the energatives, would come on this side, right? Even though it has only one argument. But Ram, Ko, Chiriya, Dikhi has two arguments, but it would come on this side. Because the point is, it would have no external argument, right? But that, I don't want to put that in right now into this exercise because often the ways of determining whether something is unergative or unaccusative, that's tricky. So we want to keep that as a separate exercise so that this work that we do. So here's a short, so I was involved in this annotation effort at IIIT Hyderabad, and one thing that I learned as being part of that exercise is that when one is trying to do annotation, it's a good idea, when one is trying to do this kind of classification, it's a good idea to separate the hard stuff and the easy stuff. Okay, so there are things about which we can be very sure, about which we will all agree. And there are going to be areas which are not where there is going to be, we will disagree with each other. Okay, so it's a good idea that we keep them separate because then at least the part where we agree, we can be certain that, there's no dispute here. This is the part, this is the fuzzy part, and then we can try and understand why it's fuzzy. So we want to keep these, people study this. This is called inter-annotator agreement. So when, we live in the age of big data, and so we need data, but the data does not fall from the sky in many, many cases, not just for linguistic data, but just for almost any kind of data, you have to have people annotate it with respect to some feature or the other, and then you want to see how much, to what extent do even people agree, right? So I think the unergative and unaccusative distinction is going to be a tricky one. We will spend some time on it when we do cross-divisation, but we don't want that to be the primary focus. Okay, so that is the project that we want everyone to do, but people can form groups together and submit work together for this part. Okay. The second project is an optional project. And that project is that that project is very open-ended. Basically, we'll give you more suggestions, but if you found if you can take forward any of the data that you've seen in this class and analyze it, so you can do two things. You can add a theoretically informed description of something that has not come up. So for example, like you guys thought about the Hindi ergativity case. So you guys found a different pattern, right? So you could think about how you could analyze that pattern, okay? So one thing is, you could just describe that pattern, okay? Because we talked about it very quickly, but then it will get lost, right? So you say, okay, this is the pattern described in Mahajan. This is the pattern that we have, okay? Likewise, any pattern that has come up in this class, right? We discuss. So for example, and just pulling this out of my head, like one thing that we saw was that certain case markers, I think in Gujarati and Marathi, are sensitive to the five features of their NPs, right? I don't know that this has been described. It would be worth describing this very carefully and thinking about how you would model it, what kind of system you would write down in order to deliver that, and whether those five features on those NPs have any impact anywhere, right? We saw that this problem probably has an impact when you were doing coordination, right? So whoever had those intuitions, you could take that, write it out, describe it in a way, in a freestanding way. So you want to write down these things don't have to be very long, but they should be such that they're like field notes. So you say, okay, here is a certain pattern, this is what, and if you feel ready to do a theoretical, a formal description, you can put it. So, but always when you're writing these things out, write the facts out in a relatively theory neutral way, write them out in a way that people who don't necessarily share your theoretical convictions can still benefit from that, right? Because not everyone is on the same page with respect to the analytical devices, right? But once you've done that, then go back and I say theory neutral. In reality, nothing is theory neutral because the questions that you ask come to you from your theory. Otherwise, I have this T-shirt which I got at one point. It says, it's from some anthropologist. It says, it is said that the data speak for themselves. I have been in rooms full of data and listened very carefully. They never said a word. So I think data by themselves, but once you come to the data from a certain angle, and I think most linguists, or maybe I would say all linguists, have a certain way of thinking, and this goes back, like when I read these old grammars written in like 1900 or 1850 or something, you realize that you are speaking the same language. They have the same instincts. They are going for certain generalizations. That is, so we want to write at that level. We have a certain idea of what a grammar, what a linguistic system looks like. The second part is, of course, we want to formalize it and we want to implement it. That's going to be separate. Okay. So that's the second part. And so all of this is going to be due by midnight on the 28th. And we want them by PDF, send them to my email address and to your email address. Okay. And what we will do on the 29th and in part on the 29th and 30th is we will address some of the issues. We won't be able to address all the issues, so there won't be any presentations because we realize we don't have enough time. So, but what I will try to do is I'll go through what you found, and I'll try to address some of the point out some of the things that have emerged, so that we have a sense of what we have accomplished as a group, and then people will get individual comments, and that's also what will get graded. But you will get individual comments on what you found, okay? Not necessarily in class, maybe in personal meetings, maybe in over email, okay? So there are two projects. The second project is slightly more, it's slightly more theoretically involved, but it's the second project is more specific, right? Which is pick something. And I bet everyone will have had something here that struck them as surprising or curious, okay? Talk about that. Write it in a way that you could then put it on your website, that somebody, you could say, okay, this is what I found. And the first project is in some sense a project that we are all doing. That is a group project. And for that, you will all submit like your individual, you will all submit, what should we do? Like if three people work on this herb classification project together, is it okay if they submit one? Okay, so then put your names together on it and submit, yeah. But it would actually be good if all the speakers of a given language, especially if there are lots, if people don't all work together. Because it will be interesting to see the divergences that appear, right? Because there will be, yeah, so for you that will be easy, but for some other languages, yeah. So, okay. Any questions about this?
And also, if they are working in a group, within the group, they can mention.
Yes. So, there is one lesson from this course is do not suppress variation. Variation exists. We should embrace it, and we should try to understand its roots. But there's no point trying to say and. Despite that, and we're also not saying that when there is variation, then you should do a union of judgments. Don't do a union of judgments. That is the path to boredom, right? But just recognize that there are yours, you're just wrong. And I think that is quite unhelpful. That is not the game we are playing. But it also, it shouldn't be that, oh, you are claiming this, I am claiming this. Since your judgments are different from mine, your theory is wrong. That my theory cannot be wrong because your judgments are different from mine. My theory can be wrong if you make a prediction about my data, and I agree with that, because oftentimes this happens with me, that like, or sometimes what's even worse is when your own judgments don't fit your theory, then it's the most embarrassing because you wish your judgments were different, but they're not. So, but that's good because that means we're keeping things honest. Yeah. Okay, so that's answer.
Anybody has any questions, any doubts regarding the assignment?
Yeah.
Can you mark for it, so be very clear of.
Yeah.
Get some time to take to work on it, because after the sessions, stop thinking.
So one thing we could do is, here's a thought, we could take an extra hour after lunch maybe. So right now, we start right at 2:30, we could start at 3:30, and so maybe people could use the hour in between, unless that would cut down on our work time too much. I don't know, what would you, and actually here's a thought, that maybe we have 2 to 3:30, we're all, let's say we are here, 2 to 3:30, but it's working time, and I'm also here, we're all here, and so people are working, and as you guys work together, you will probably have questions and you will get stuck. And we'll be here to consult.
I think 12 to 1 is a better idea.
12 to 1, okay.
Because that 1 hour slot, then we can break for lunch and they can keep on thinking.
Okay, sure. So then we start at 10. We go from 10 to 12 and then we have tea. And then we have a break.
Yes.
And you guys work for until lunch. And we are still here.
We assemble at 2:30.
Yeah, and then we reassemble it.
So we get 2 hours, including lunch.
Yeah. So that's the idea.
In the first project, you mentioned about the subjects.
Yeah.
You don't have.
So no. So then, of course, then you don't do that. So
just ignore that.
Completely. So this is not an idea. This is not the idea that everything has to have exactly the same categories. So here's what I would say. It is quite possible that manga has some other exciting categories that I did not think of. That doesn't mean you should not write. And same thing for any other language, right? Like if you find, for example, that a particular class, I don't know, I mean, I'm just making this up. I know Tamil has reflexive verbs. And like if a particular class has to appear with the reflexive morpheme, right? Or for example, that a certain class of verbs can take the reflexive morpheme and another class cannot, right? That could be.
Yeah, as you're saying, some verbs can take the alternations, because for the pre-class work, I was seeing that some verbs can't take the same alternation.
Right. So that would be the work. So there is no sense in which you all have to, all the languages have to do the same classification. But with respect to like the case frames, that's going to be the same for all languages, but purgativity will vary. Also, many languages will not quite have a straightforward open alternation. It may be, you might have the intuition that you have to open, but they look the same, and that's fine. You can note that. Because it is, why not? English has two opens which look the same. So just because Hindi makes a phonological